Right, so we need to understand how to move forward with the studying, the preparation, the hard work part, right? So let's see. So when you're looking at the exams, how do we start off, where to study from and all? We've discussed study material and all of that. Now how do you start studying in the practice part? So when you're looking at the studying, the first is obviously the introduction lecture which you're actually attending right now. So you need to get an overview of the level, the exam that you're taking, what study material and resources that are required, how to study and practice we are understanding. You need to, very important, you need to understand the curriculum, because you need to have a holistic approach in terms of what you're going to study. There could be a lot of interconnectedness between the chapters and all that. So it is important to get an idea of the syllabus, because you have to know what subjects are there, how the curriculum has been divided and everything. That is very important. So don't not do the syllabus lecture. You have to do the syllabus lecture first. You have to understand what is going to be the entire content of the syllabus before you start. It sets the tempo of your studying. It is important. You have to do this. Right. Next, obviously, there is going to be, after you've done this, you have a broad idea as to where you're supposed to study from and you know how to go about it. So you have all the information to begin preparation. You're in the mode. You understand the curriculum and all. There is an order of study that is provided to you. So order of study is basically that tells you in which order you're supposed to start off. So for example, for CFA and FRM level 1, both the levels, you have to do the time value of money first to start off with the preparation. Because if you do not do that, there are other lot of different topics and chapters and all that you will not be able to solve. So there is a particular order of study you have to follow because of the lot of dependencies between the chapters. As you move towards level 2, level 3 of CFA or level 2 FRM, the order of study becomes little less important, little less important, because what happens is you already have the basics. You understand finance, you understand the basic subjects of finance and all. So then it is not so much of a problem because you already know most of the terms and all that you are using. And then we build up. But still, you know, there is a very logical way. I spend a lot of time and I actually update the order of study every year. And there is a particular reason why it is done this way, because your attention is going to be an issue. So those chapters are going to be towards the end, and the dependencies have to be sorted out as to which chapter is required to study this chapter. So that chapter has to be towards the end, and the chapter that is needed to study this chapter has to be done before. So all those things are taken care of. So the order of study is very important. You have to follow that particular sequence. You do the first couple of chapters so that you know you get into the study mode and you've started studying, you're understanding, okay, these are the chapters and all, especially for level 1 students. Level 2, it doesn't, after level 1 it is not so much of a challenge because you're already into the mode of studying, you've understood how to go about it and all. So you do a couple of chapters. The first two chapters will be a little bit of an issue, not an issue but rather a little challenging, because you know you're starting off, there's something new, so there is always resistance to change any kind, and especially those working professionals and all who are getting back to studying after a while. So the first, they always often ask me this question, but the first 7-8 hours of studying the first 2-3 chapters is always a problem. But after that, what happens is you're back to being a student. You're always going to be a student throughout life. So the first couple of chapters is to get in the mode of studying. Even other students, even the students, full-time students, since you're studying finance, it is the subjects could be new for you. In all probability, most probably the subjects will be relatively new. So when you're studying finance, the first couple of chapters takes time to, you know, set the tempo in. So don't get irritated. It is normal with everybody. You start studying with a couple of chapters. So for level 1 of both CFA FRM, I've uploaded the lectures on YouTube, the first few chapters of quants and all. In fact, for all the levels, there is one or two chapters here and there that has been posted, and proper playlists are made on YouTube. So you can go through that till the time you get comfortable with my way of teaching and everything. So you can do that. And obviously the calculator lecture has to be attended by level 1 students, because they don't know how to use a calculator. After level 1, basically what happens is you can revisit those portions of the calculator lecture which you have forgotten, the buttons or the functionalities which you are not comfortable with. Other than that, it is fine, because you already know the calculator lecture and how to use the calculator and all. But still, if you feel like, just make sure you go through, there is I think 11 or 12 lectures, it's also there on YouTube, so you can just check which particular button, which particular function you are not comfortable with. If you're comfortable with all the buttons, then it's fine. Otherwise, you go through the lecture again. So after you do a couple of chapters, there is very important, you have the how to study and how to practice lecture. So how to study and how to practice lecture becomes very important, because on a level specific basis, so when you're cracking level 1 or when you're studying for level 2 part 2, then in that case the approach towards curriculum, the way you have to practice, from where to practice, which chapters you need to practice more, which chapters you can practice a little less, see, because you have to understand, you have unlimited resources available. there is too many, there are too many things, a lot of confusion because there are a lot of advices available. So you will have, so I'm going to give you tangibly exactly what you need to do, and you need to follow that, because you cannot, so I always say that you cannot study from three sources. For example, if I want to, I've already mentioned this when I was talking about the material or in another lecture, that, you know, when we are in the exam, we always say that, you know, it was written on the left side or the right side, bottom of the page, and I'm not being able to recall. There is always a recall factor. That is the reason why it is important that you don't study the same concept from three books. So you have to be very clear that I'm going to study from this place, I'm going to practice from this place. Once it is completed, once the curriculum is over, then with revision, I will decide what more practice I have to do. But there has to be a level, there has to be targets and all set. I'll come to that. So how exactly you're supposed to be studying, how to make notes and all that, and how to exactly to be practicing, which chapters, where to practice more or less, etc. That is included in your performance tracker over there. And then, what all sources to practice from, which source to practice from first. So I'll tell you exactly all of these things are provided. So that is discussed in the how to study and how to practice lecture. Also, for example, if you're starting preparation late, in that case, you have less time for practice. Then how do you practice? If you have decent time, then what do you practice? So the priority part, that, you know, this is the bare minimum practice you have to do. This chapter, you practice more. This chapter, even if it is you don't have time, you practice less. So all those things have to be taken care of. And there are mistakes sheet, tricks sheet. So now what you have to understand is, when you're taking these kind of exams, we don't have 7-8 exams, 7-8 subjects and 7-8 exam papers like in school or college we used to have, taking 700-800 marks. Here you have 60, 70, 80, 100, whatever number of MCQs, and based on that you're going to be tested. So every single MCQ, every single mark is like 1%, 0.6%, 0.7% or whatever, depending on the level. So that becomes very challenging because you don't have so much scope for making mistakes. So how to avoid mistakes? There is a mistake sheet we do. There is a trick sheet we do, because there's so much of practice and so much of work we are doing. So how do you revise? You have to study in such a way that you're in a good position when you're doing revision, because ultimately what you're studying for 4, 5, 6, 7 months, whatever time frame you're taking. And then when you have to revise all that you have studied in these months, because only what you revise, you'll be able to retain and answer questions in the exam. And how do you approach questions? Because questions, see, again, it is not subjective. These are MCQ exams. So, and the questions, even if the questions are going to be absolutely conceptual, there will be no straightforward question, define this, define that, what is the difference between this, similarity between this, explain that, nothing of that sort. They're very analytical question. So that is the reason why the approach, how you approach the questions, and also that is why how you study and practice is very important. So notes and how to make your notes, how to write down tricks, how to manage your time, how to schedule your studies, how to set your targets, etc. All those things are explained in the how to study and practice lecture. Level 1 students, at least let them get an idea about how a chapter looks like in a couple of chapters. Then they do this lecture so as to move forward properly. Level 2 onward students can simply watch this lecture first, attend this lecture first, and then they can start with the remaining curriculum. So that is how we go about it. And all these things are provided, these sheets and all that, and then importance level of chapters, tracker, etc. And every chapter wise, you know, how lengthy is a chapter, how confusing is a chapter, how much to practice every chapter. So all those details are specified. Then what happens is you continue studying after how to study and how to practice lecture is completed. You continue studying. Now the format of study is going to be very simple, and very importantly, you attend the lecture. You do not study by yourself first. You always attend the lecture. Then you practice, or then you study by yourself. You have to study. You're not mugging up, but you're studying. If I've explained the concept of something, you have explained certain topic. Then after that, I've explained, obviously I'm going to explain the entire topic A to Z. But after that, you have to study. You have to make sure that I've understood everything. I'm learning, I'm understanding the concept. I'm being able to connect the entire chapter, and I've understood everything very, very well. So you have to study, no mugging up, but you have to learn. Even in an MCQ, you'll have to be able to answer questions. So you'll have to do that. And then you have to practice. And when you're practicing, you have to understand. I've seen students, they'll do all the lectures first, then they want to study and practice later. Very bad idea. I've seen students who want to do all the lectures first, lecture studying first, and then they want to practice later. Very bad idea. Even if you're in a stressful situation in terms of that, you know, your preparation level is poor because you have less time left, and or you're working professional and you're having difficulty in terms of managing your time and all. So I'll tell you exactly that, okay, this much practice you do first, the remainder practice we'll do with revision. So I keep on guiding you. So all those things I'll provide, but you cannot do zero practice. You cannot do zero practice until unless you have like 2-3 months left and you're absolutely in a bad position, and you have to first complete the curriculum, and then we'll have to think about practice. So that will depend on a different situation. All those things I specify in the how to practice lecture. So don't worry about it. And obviously, when I'm doing lectures and all, there could be every single LOS, every single learning outcome statement is going to be covered. And I would be giving you short notes around the chapter or something. And anything extra that you need to write, I'll not be dictating the whole chapter notes and all that. Either my class notes are given or you're referring to your Schweizer textbooks. And beside that, whatever extra is needed, I'm going to be explanation, extra derivation of formula, etc. is going to be provided. And And obviously for practice in CFA level 3, you have to write the answers. So there is another very important lecture I have to do is how to write answers, how to write essay type answers. It's not essay, it's actually small answers, short answers, but how to go about it. So that is only relevant for CFA level 3 students. Then after that, you look at completing, obviously you're completing the syllabus. Now, monthly target is going to be provided. So for example, you'll have different WhatsApp groups, for example, FRM, part one, group A, group B, group C, group D and all. So you'll have multiple WhatsApp groups. You'll be part of one WhatsApp group. And every month and I take an update in terms of how many chapters each of the students have completed. Based on that, I'll give you a monthly target. I'll tell you that if you have completed on an average these many chapters, in that case, this is how you should do in this month. So based on the, and I also give you an average as to how other students are faring. So based on that, I give you a guidance on a monthly basis. Your doubt sessions and all are there. All those things are taken care of. Then your doubts and all are there in the app also. We have difficult questions and all put over there. How do you focus? How to retain, etc. All those guidance and everything is provided throughout your curriculum. So as you're moving with the chapters, these things keep on taking place. The duration of the classes and all I've discussed separately in when I've discussed that lecture, when to start, how when to begin preparation. So the duration of each of the levels is different, I've told you. There is no selective studying that you're allowed to do because the questions could be from anywhere and every single MCQ, every single mark is very, very important. I've told you the weightage of every single MCQ is very high as compared to what it used to be in school board exams, college exams and all. And the targets and all I told you I'll be providing. And also when we do the how to study and practice lecture, I'll tell you how to make your schedule. So I will give you a tracker and all of those things and all that. But based on when you're starting your preparation, you will understand how to make your routine and how to set your targets, that how many chapters, how many hours you'll have to study per week and all those things will be taken care of in that lecture. Once your syllabus is complete, obviously you attend the how to revise lecture. So how do you need to revise depending on your situation and all that, and how to take a mock test, because mock test is going to be after your syllabus is completed. How many mock tests to take, which mock test to take, how to take the mock test, how to attend the mock test, etc. is discussed. Then you start with your revision and mock tests and all, and depending on your situation, you might have certain amount of practice that is pending which you need to do with revision. So what to revise with, what to practice with revision and all is going to be taken care of. And then you have your mind maps and all, that is your flowcharts and all that if you wish to refer. Or there are students, and I personally used to like, you know, whatever notes I used to make in the margin, I used to study that used to be easier for me to revise, underlining and revising. I'll teach you how to do that when you're doing the how to study lecture. And then or otherwise you can go through the flowchart and mind maps and all that, the summary and all that. And once your mock test is done, then your analysis is being done, and when to take the mock test, how many days before the exam, we'll have to specify that. You can't take any mock test in last 7 days or 8 days before the exam, because that is going to create a problem during the exam time. And based on your mock scores, when you take the mock test, you have to give your scores and you have to give an analysis to me, how many questions were wrong because of silly mistake, etc. and all that. And based on that, a mock analysis is provided and an approach that how you need to study or prepare or how to revise and all that in the next 7-8 days. And then there is a most important lecture, that is how to attempt lecture. Out of all the lectures and everything, the most important, obviously, provided you've studied for the chapter. And how to attempt lecture is basically all the exam tricks and all that. There is no shortcuts and all, I've told you repeatedly. Please, there is no shortcut to success, there is no shortcut to understanding concepts, etc. Even if you take shortcut and just crack the exam somehow, you'll get stuck in the next level if your concepts, if your base, if your foundation is not strong. And even if you do that, in that case, in office work, in promotions, etc., you will get stuck. In client work, etc., you will get stuck. So that is not going to work. How to attempt lecture is basically managing time, which order to attempt the exam, and a lot of things. In fact, I remember doing a 45-minute lecture on how to attempt the exam, you know, exam day and what to carry, and all those things are also there for level 1. And there is no out-of-syllabus questions and all that turn up generally. Maybe one MCQ or two MCQ at times if it turns up, but otherwise the curriculum is very well defined because of the LOS, every chapter, the subheads of the chapter, and everything is covered, so there is no problem over there. And then of course you take your exam, and along with that I'll be very pushy in terms of, you know, you need to start reading, you need to start working on yourself, you need to continuously be improving yourself. And I don't like to restrict myself to just the curriculum part. Of course, the curriculum is the most important part here. But along with that, and you can check that on social media and all these things also, this Instagram and all is there, and LinkedIn and all. I keep posting whatever I'm reading, whatever I'm applying, whatever I'm learning. So even in the groups, I'll keep on giving you, you know, I like to post a little article or something here and there. And then, for example, the chapters you do, so the doubts, and then say, for example, some chapter has got some good blog article or something relevant, some movie or something which is related, like Bernie Madoff died. So Bernie Madoff was one of the most, one of the biggest Ponzi schemes that he was running. So there is a chapter in FRM part 2 on him. So I put a movie recommendation for that. There is a movie on about him, Wizard of Lies. Or for example, hyperinflation I was talking about, or Nash equilibrium, let's say in CFA. So I'll put a application based video of that. So all those things are there, and articles or whatever I'm reading and everything, or whatever advice I want to give, I keep on pinging in the WhatsApp groups and all that. So that is more or less it. That is how you need to go about in terms of your preparation and all. And obviously level specific, how you need to practice and all those things separately is provided. And also, you know, starting your preparation last moment, difficulty level of different practice sources, so that you know difficulty level of practice sources with respect to the exam. I have nothing to do with any of the institutes, but still, you know, just getting an idea as to difficulty level with respect to the exams and all. So I give these, there are a lot of these kind of answers also that is made and provided to you, so that you can peg yourself that, okay, this is the kind of question I'm doing, or this practice source has this level of questions, and I'm faring in this way. Now the exam level is going to be higher or it's going to be lower than that. So all those things are provided. You have to make sure that you people are working very, very hard. You people are studying with a lot of focus and attention. It's not the number of hours, but it's the amount of concentration in the hours that you're doing. So how much of studies, how much of, you know, learning that you're deriving from that hour is very important. You dare not touch your phone while doing my lectures. I'm telling you, I get very irritated because I know, because when the doubts come to me, I know that, you know, I tell in the I'm saying in the class that in this chapter, in this kind of question, these kind of questions could turn up, and this is the approach. Or in these kind of questions, you might make this mistake. Don't dare to make that mistake. And I've seen students asking me the same question in doubts. Obviously, they get a scolding. I'll obviously solve your question, but obviously you're going to get a scolding, because that means you have been inattentive during class. And obviously, if there is something extra or something new that has turned up, let's say I've seen a mistake that you have made, and I think that others could also make a mistake, so a warning, I'll put it in your app. So when you go through the curriculum and all that, so some difficult questions, other students doubt, clarity, etc., that is needed in maybe certain terms or something, all that you will find in the app. So so all those things are there. So everybody has access to all these things. So concepts have to be very, very thorough. There is no mugging up. You're not supposed to be watching, looking at your emails, looking at your Instagram and all that while doing attending the lectures. Anyways, while attending the lectures on your laptop, no other function is going to be working in the background. You cannot minimize the lecture. It runs on my software. Nothing else works on your computer at that point of time. So you have to be very, very careful that when you're attending the lecture. And another thing, try to stretch yourself for at least 2.5-3 hours in one sitting when you're doing classes and all, because you have to get in the flow, into that mode of studying, in order to understand, because there is a flow, you know. It's not like one concept is 20 minutes and I'm done with it. It does not work that way. These corporate trainings and all are separate, because that is not meant to crack an exam like this and to understand finance or a subject like this. You're studying subject. In school also you study for long duration, so you have to try to stretch yourself for 2.5-3 hours at least at a stretch. Formulas also, there could be certain most of the formulas we'll try and derive whatever is relevant. There could be certain formulas which is calculus based and all. I'll give you an idea how to go about it. Or there could be formulas, you know, to understand the logic. So there is a formula, let's say something minus something divided by something, let's say. Now why is it minus and why is it not plus? You have to know the logic, because what if you're confused in the exam that whether this was minus or this was plus, whether this was in the numerator or this was in the denominator. So even if you're not deriving the formula, you need to understand the logic, the concept, the motive behind the formula, because otherwise it is going to be very problematic in order to take the exam. You're understanding the idea. So this becomes very important. You have to understand the formulas. You cannot just mug up the formulas. It's not going to help you. And also, if I modify the question, or if I change the approach of the question a little bit, in that case, if you're not able to apply the formula as it is, then what do you do? Don't defer practice. I've seen students, as I already told you, that they want to complete the entire curriculum and practice at the end. That is a very bad idea, because you know, when you're studying and while studying, you, when you practice, you understand that whether my level of preparation is good, as in, is my concentration sufficient? Is the amount of learning I'm doing, is it enough? Do I need to increase the intensity? Do I need to increase the duration of learning? Like after attending the lecture, should I study for longer duration because I'm not being able to answer questions? What level of difficulty of the is the questions? So therefore, how do I go about my studying and preparation? That is why don't defer practice. In the how to practice lecture long, I'll tell you if you are in a bad situation in terms of if you have less time available, in that case, how to manage your practice in a certain way that you have less practice now and maybe more practice with revision. I'll tell you all those things, but don't delay practice to the end. 100% practice at the end is not allowed. Focus level, I've already told you, EQ has to be very strong. So you can't be comparing with people. You can't be saying that, okay, this person has completed so many chapters, I'm in such a bad shape and all that. Doesn't work. So even if, say, for example, 20 days you give me without any phone call, without any phone office work, any communication with anybody, 20 days I'll be able to study 14 hours a day and do a 280 hour job. And 280 hours I'll be able to do amazing amount of work. Let's say on an average there are 70 chapters or 60 chapters. In that case, I'm getting more than 4.5 hours per chapter. So 4.5 hours per chapter, I'm going to be able to absolutely manage the entire curriculum even in 20 days. I'm not asking you to do the curriculum in 20 days and all that way, but I'm just giving an example that it is about the concentration, the level of focus you have, the EQ. You have to be very, very strong, and especially, you know, with college and work and everything to manage together, studies and all that and the office and everything, it becomes a challenge. Retention, again, the focus level has to be high. So how do you improve your retention? And that is why the order of study becomes important and how to retain and all those things are discussed. Revision is important, obviously, because only when you are revising whatever you've studied, you have to revise it so as to be able to retain and then answer questions in the exam. One revision has to be done, and how to go about it, we discuss. You have to follow instructions. A lot of students I see is that I'm giving instructions, they're not following it, and then at the end of the day, they're going to be suffering because of that. For example, I give an analysis of the past year mock tests and all that. Past year analysis is given. So you have to see the analysis, understand that what mistakes the last batches have made. So when I'm studying, when I'm attempting my exam, I am not going to make the same mistakes. But at times students ignore that because probably they are not doing this lecture very seriously and they're not noting down these things. And another thing is you have to be very, very humble. I will not tolerate any student misbehaving, talking rudely, and also, you know, in order to grasp the concepts, you have to be very humble. I have to always know that I know nothing about finance also, because only if I have that mentality, if I have that attitude, I'm going to continue reading, continue getting more information, for example, cryptocurrency or blockchain, or when I'm looking at NFT and all. Or say, for example, I did a training for Tata on SaaS based valuation. So I cannot say that I know everything. I have to keep on learning, keep on reading. There is so much of change. 10 years back, nobody would have studied valuations of NFT. But today, that is there. So I have to read about it. You have to learn. So you have to be very humble when you're approaching anything. Do not get overconfident. And especially, you know, with people with a little experience tend to be a little overconfident at times. So make sure that you're not making that mistake. You have to be very humble when you're studying, when you're learning. You have to have that, you know, in order to absorb, you have to absorb. It requires this humility. So understand that. And that's all. Vidya dadati vinayam, vinaya dyati patritam. So anyways, so knowledge, education, humility, ability. So anyways, I'll explain that some other day, but you need to be able to grasp concepts this way. You have to study, you'll have to put your heart and soul into it when you're studying, when you're absorbing, and you'll enjoy the process. You'll have to enjoy the learning process. The outcome is learning throughout this time frame. Right? Comfortable? And you'll start enjoying. The classes are not going to be as boring as probably this lecture is sounding, because right now I'm trying to be more informational. I'm not teaching any topic. I'm not being able to use examples from some movie or some series or some ridiculous example like... probably when I discuss takeover, so mergers acquisition, I'm just thinking of bad examples that I use in class. merges. There was this hostile takeover or something. I discuss this DV number one movies example. I don't know if you people have seen this ridiculous movie where Karishma Kapoor does a hostile takeover of a company's firm because she had 51% stake in the company and Salman Khan had 49% stake in the company. So weird examples and all I keep on using in the class. It helps you to connect, or examples from maybe books or movies or something. So these things also help you to connect. So that is why I was telling you that application also, you know, hyperinflation, etc. So I'll keep on giving you those examples here and there in the class, corporates, whatever is happening around in the economy and all. So it's important. Also, you have to read. I'll be pushing you to read throughout. I'll be very nagging. I'll be nagging you a lot in terms of, you know, to push you towards reading. You have to start reading. You have to start understanding how to apply your knowledge also. This is going to get you through the exam. But after the exam, what do you do? Then for that, you have to improve your writing skills. I'll be pestering you to do that as well. Right? You'll have to improve your communication skills. You'll have to work on all these aspects. Right? So this is more or less about how to study and how to practice for your exam.